Brothers and sisters, how y'all doing? Sister Scribbling, Brother Stewart, Pastor, how you doing today? Lord is good. Jackie, how you doing? Got a great lesson tonight. Great lesson. Lord is good. All the time. All the time. Lord is good. I surely will bring it on. I hope y'all got some good response for me tonight on the questions that I have. Amen. Good evening, brother. Good to see everybody. Lord is good. Lord is truly good. It is indeed a good day. Another day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And we're going to continue on with our study. In these times, we need to always look to the one that keeps us and watches over us, the one that guides us and protects us. And in these times, we need him more than we would ever need him before, because time is winding up. Time is truly winding up. And if we're not careful, some people will get left behind, or they'll lose everything because they're seeking this world. And we got to realize that we can't seek the world anymore. We can't do the things that we used to do. We can't live the way we used to live. We can't say the things we used to say. And we can't seek out life the way we used to. We must change. We must make a change. And sometimes I think we just forget the changes that we must take. Sometimes I think we just forget. We let things go and we go about our own way. But God said this is not so. That's why he's always searching, always seeking out his children, that we may change. So that's why I wanted to bring up tonight's lesson. Tonight, we're going to go back and we're going to briefly go over last week's lesson, which was Romans 8, 31 through 39. If you would turn back to Romans 31, Romans 8, 31 and 39, and if you're there, we're going to go ahead and pray and allow the Holy Spirit to have his way. Father, in your precious Son, Jesus' name, Lord Father, again, we thank you indeed for another day's journey. We thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your loving kindness. We thank you for all that you have done in our past, our present, and what you are about to do in our future. Lord, we're seeking you for the answers that we need. And Father, as we struggle, as we go through this barren land, as we are walking through this life, trying to get home to you, Lord, give us the strength, the endurance to do the things that you would have us to do. We love you, Lord. We glorify you, magnify you, lift up your name above all other names. And Father, you deserve all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. Now, Lord, we pray for the sick, the shut-in. We pray for those who are in bereavement. We pray for the lost, Lord, that they may come in before it is too late. Lord, Father, have your way in us and through us. that your people may be a people who go out and do your will, seek and do everything that you have instructed us to do. That one day when we stand before you, Lord, we will have the, we will be given the crown, Lord, of everlasting life, Lord. We thank you, Father. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment. We thank you for everything that will transpire. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Remember last week's lesson? Last week's lesson was very interesting, to say the least, because we went through the whole Bible and we came back to Romans 8, 31 and 39. So I'm going to read that again, because tonight's lesson will have a connection to last week's lesson. Romans 8, 31 through 39. I'll read that. And it says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Is it God who justified? Isn't it God who justified? Who is he who condemns? Is it Christ who died and furthermore is also raised up? Who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor heights, nor depths, nor any other created things shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Very interesting that God has put everything in place for us to be blessed, for us to be strengthened, for us to be able to do his divine will. Now we're going to go to Hebrews 12, 1 and 3. Hebrews 12, 1 and 3. And now it's going to get even more interesting, because we have to now turn from the ways we are going. Sometimes we turn back because we're afraid. Sometimes we turn back because we get convinced by others to turn and go another direction. We no longer turn toward God. We turn to everything else, as we discussed last week. But I want to give you a nugget. I want to give you something very special that God has allowed all of us tonight to hear. Hebrews 12, 1 through 3 reads, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with the endurance the race that is set before us." The key verse. "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Verse 3, "For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your soul." So from last week to this week, we are realizing now that Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. It wasn't that once we receive God that everything is set, everything is done. We don't have to worry about troubles anymore. We don't have to worry about sin. We don't have to think about sin. We don't have to do anything that the world is doing. But then we would be called a liar. And also God would be called a liar because Jesus Christ said himself, if they hate me, they will hate you. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. That's a very sombering statement that he made, because he knew that we would have to go through. We would have to suffer some things before we get home. He said, I'll go away and prepare a place for you and receive you when I return, but he has not returned yet. So that means that we must look to him constantly for our strength and our guidance. We must look to the Holy Spirit so the Holy Spirit can fill us with the power to endure. Now, if we think about that just for a minute, God has strengthened us to do many things in this world, many things, heroic things. But when it gets personal, when we are by ourselves and there's no one around, or we are giving an opportunity to do wrong, the question is, do we do the right thing? Do we seek God? Do we keep our place where God has put us? Or do we go astray? Remember Israel. Israel wanted to go back to Egypt due to the fact that Israel was afraid to go on, afraid that things were just too hard for them to handle. And Moses kept spurring them on, saying the Lord has something greater. But we must venture on that side of the Red Sea in order to get it. Sometimes we get weary and well-doing. Sometimes we want to do the right thing, but we hear that evil voice on the side of us saying, nah, you don't have to do that. God doesn't want you to do that. God doesn't want you to give. God doesn't want you to give that young man advice or to help that young lady. God doesn't want you to do that. And then you'll have the human friends will come around, who we call friends. And they will say, man, don't worry about that. Somebody else can do it. You shouldn't have to worry about doing all that. God has told us, and he has called us. He said, I will complete everything that I told you I will complete. But you must endure, because I've opened the door to heaven to you freely. I've given you salvation freely because I paid the price. Christ paid the price on the cross. But he never said that we won't have to endure anything. That's why we must look to him, the author and the finisher of our faith. He does not just start it, but he will complete us in due time. But we must endure to the end. We must endure to the end. Now, I'm just going to give you, we're going to go back. You know, I like to travel through the Bible and look at examples that God has given us so that we may be strong in his words. We must be strong in spirit. Have our mind set on the things of Christ, not on the things of this world. Because if you have been looking at everything in this world and you have been taking your opportunity to go out and be like the world, my question to you tonight, how is it looking for you? How are things going? If you have abandoned Christ and have set out to do your own thing, how is it going? How are things without God? How are things going with you doing it on your own, seeking your own way, turning aside to the world? Let's see a response from someone. You know, how is it going? Have the world drawn you away? Or are you holding on to the everlasting arm or everlasting hand of Christ? This is the question tonight. And this is the reason why God gave me Hebrews 12, 1 through 3. God said, whatever I start, I will finish. That means in his own children, he will finish it. He doesn't look for you to be absolutely perfect. You won't. He doesn't look for you to be the smartest person on earth. You're not. He doesn't look for you to be the strongest person on this earth. You're not. But you're his child. Whatever he has started in you, he will finish. He has guaranteed that. And he said, I cease to be God if I don't keep my word. Remember back in the Old Testament, he told Abraham, he said, I will keep my word and I will make a great nation. Matter of fact, the whole earth will be blessed by you through being obedient unto me. We sometimes forget our ways. We sometimes forget where we're supposed to be. But we need to endure to the end. Hebrews 1 and 10. Let's look at that. Hebrews 1 and 10. Y'all writing this down? I know y'all writing this down. Because one day it's going to be a lot of questions asked, and I hope y'all can answer those questions for me. Hebrews 1 through 10. It says, 1 and 10. It says, you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. The heavens, the earth, everything is made by God. Everything. You know, scientists will tell you, will say very quickly that it was the big boom, or we just crawled out of the ocean somewhere and started crawling and got 2 feet and swung around in the trees and everything. The scientists would say these things. The scientist wasn't there. The scientist wasn't there. But the world is designed to keep you off course, to tell you everything but how good God truly is, to fool you into thinking that there is no God, and to tell you that you are your own person. You can say, you can do, you can achieve anything you want apart from God. They have been lying. They have been leading us in the wrong direction. And we have been foolish enough to follow them. Even when it comes to protesting and fighting for rights, civil rights, there's always, Satan has always been around leading us slightly to the left or slightly to the right. And we never complete the things that we're supposed to complete because we don't look to the author and the finisher of our faith. We look to one another. We look to the world. We want the world to lead us. So, when are we going to change our minds? When are we going to change from following the world to following Christ? If you would turn to me to Hebrews 3, 12 through 14. Hebrews 3, 12 through 14. It's all right here. Everything, every question we have ever asked is right here. Hebrews 12, Hebrews 3, 12 to 14. And it reads, beware, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart and of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold to the beginning of our confidence, steadfast to the end. He didn't say steadfast to halfway. He said steadfast to the end. See it through. But do we see it through? Do we see it through, or do we get weary halfway through? Sometimes most of our blessings we don't get. And you know why we don't get? Because we don't endure to the end. When things get hard, when things get, when it seems like there's no hope, there's no one to turn to, we turn back. In a lot of ways, we are like the children of Israel, our ancestors. We want to turn back. When God has told us too many times, I'll finish it if you endure. I'll finish it if you do not give up. I'll finish it if you do not lose faith. I'll finish. He said he'll finish it. Not that we will finish it. He will finish it. If you look through the Bible, many times the battle that Israel went through, how and many times Israel was losing. And God allowed them to lose so they can understand one thing. Without me, you will lose. Without me, without looking to me, they will overtake you. And if you read the story of Joshua, when Joshua prayed and he said, Lord, if the sun goes down on us, we're going to lose. Lord, stop the sun. Remember, God saw the faith in Joshua, and he did not allow the sun to go down until Israel won. This is how good our God is, and this is how much he loves us. Last week, we discussed how much he loves us, how special we are to God. And too many times we lose our way. Too many times we become frustrated. We know that we're going through, you know, I know we're going through a pandemic. God knows also. But God is trying to turn our minds, our hearts, our souls back to him. He's allowing certain things to take place so we can see that the enemy is at work. And we need to be prayerful. We need to seek him. We need to put all our trust and our hope in him, not in the presidents, not in the government, not in the stimulus check that many are getting, but they're wasting. And did anyone, I want you all to remember, did anyone even thank God for what they've gotten? Because too many times the government is trying to take away from us, but God has touched them in such a way that they are now giving to us. But are we using what God has allowed us to have? And are we using it for the right reason? There's hope. But there's only hope in God. There's no hope in the things of men. Now, if you turn to me again, turn with me again, we'll go to Hebrews 10. Hebrews 10, 36 through 38. Hebrews 10, 36 through 38. Everybody ready? Y'all let me know if I'm going too fast. Hebrews 10, 36 through 38. And it reads, "For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come, and will not tarry. 38, now the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him." Isn't that interesting that if you draw back from God, and we discussed that last week, God will draw back from you. He has no pleasure in someone who gives up. The race is not given to the strong or the swift or the mighty, but it's given to the one who endureth to the end. So if you're moving slow, you're moving. If you're hobbling along, you're hobbling. But he said, endure. Endure to the end, and I will give you the crown of life. Everlasting life. But the thing is, do we want to endure? We have to make that decision. Everyone on this planet has to make that decision. Do I endure to the end to see what is there for me? Or do I turn back? Remember Lot's wife? She turned back. Remember what happened to her when she turned back? God has no pleasure in someone turning back. You are to finish the race. You must finish the race. And I want you to encourage those who you come into contact with. Finish the race. Because there's a lot of baby Christians out there that are suffering. They're wondering at the halfway point, should I turn back? The world is having more fun than what I'm having. The world is getting away with more than what I'm, getting away with crimes and doing everything that they can, but look at me. Do I turn back? So I can see what they got, so I can do what they're doing. There's a lot of Christians, young baby Christians out there that needs encouragement. And we must encourage them. Don't turn back. Keep going. God has you. God will finish in you what he started. But we must endure. We must endure. And can anyone know, do anyone know where I'm going to next? Anyone knows where I'm going to next? I'll give y'all a second to think about it. Where am I going to next? What's the next scripture? Nobody's come up with anything? I know it's there. I know y'all remember. Okay, I'll give you a hint. Hebrews 11 and 1. Hebrews 11 and 1. Y'all ready? Okay, here we go. Hebrews 11 and 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Okay, I'll go on and read number 2. It says, for by it the elders attain a good report. And understanding, number 3, by faith we understand that the worlds were formed, were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. Faith. Faith and endurance. We must have faith and endurance. Because without it, we will not survive what is about to come. A lot of people will tell you all, look, it's going to get better. We're going to go back to school. We're going to go back to life as normal. Everything will be all right. Everything will be sunny. But God has warned you that things will never be the same. And we need to get that in our minds and in our hearts. Things will never be the same. And we are now seeing all these changes that are taking place. Matter of fact, changes are taking place while we were sitting at home. A lot of people will not have jobs. A lot of people will struggle. A lot of things will take place coming very soon. But if we endure, if we trust God, he will make a way for us. He will make a way for our children. He will make a way for our grandchildren. If we endure to the end, you must have faith, brothers and sisters. You must have faith. And if you look back over the Bible, God has shown us who are the faith, who are people of faith. You remember Abraham when God told Abraham that you will be a father of many nations? Remember that? Remember in Genesis 21 and 12? Remember how Isaac came on the scene because God kept his promises. You find that in Genesis 20, verse 20 of Genesis 21. And then in verse 21 of Genesis 21, Jacob is blessed. Jacob blesses Joseph's two sons. And on in generations after generations, God has shown that I am going to complete what I started. You know how Moses' parents were not afraid of Pharaoh, kept him for 3 months, and he ended up, God blessed him in such a way that he ended up in Pharaoh's court. But he did not claim Pharaoh. He claimed his ancestors. He claimed Israel. And you remember how God raised him up and sent him back and delivered Israel. We remember how that is. It took a lot for Moses to go through all that in order for God to use him. It took a lot for you to get to where you are right now. It took a lot for you to survive. We have lost brothers and sisters. We have lost family members and our personal families. But God said, endure to the end, and I'll make everything all right. We don't know what's going truly going on behind the scenes, but God has control. He sees everything. We don't know about the crimes. We were upset about them. Things have changed, but God said, endure. I'm going to fight your battle. We are worrying about food on the table. We are worrying about the light bill. We are worrying about the mortgage, but God said, endure. Have faith, and I'll see you through. We must make decisions in our lives that will change everything, even the lives of our children. But God said, trust me, endure, have faith, pray, seek my face. You find me, seek me, and everything will work out just right. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. We can start nothing, and we can finish nothing. We must trust in God. We must trust in his word. Remember Jericho? How Israel was so bent on trusting God's will. It's kind of crazy that you march around a huge fort or a huge city for 7 days, not fighting anyone. People would think something's wrong with you. But God told them to endure, to trust him, to obey. And what happened? The walls came tumbling down. Not only that, but in the midst of all that trouble, there was a young lady by the name of Rahab who protected the spies. And if you remember correctly, Rahab was in the genealogy of Christ. This is God working out his promises, working out his work, working out his plan for mankind. So that's very interesting that through all this mess, and this is how God works, even in the midst of our troubles, even in the midst of our mess, God is working things out. And all we have to do is do our part. And which part is that? We've been discussing it all night. Which part is that? To endure and have faith. And God will complete everything that he promised. Even giving you the crown of life, eternal life. Remember Barak? Remember Samson? Remember David and Samuel and all the prophets, what they went through? Faith of God's people have brought down kingdoms. They have stopped the mouth of lions. They have kept them from death. They have made you strong when you were weak. God's love. God's love. It wasn't man's love that carried us. It was God's love. And brothers and sisters, I must encourage you also. Don't get upset when God chastises us. We get mad with God when we don't get what we want. When he doesn't do everything we want. When he doesn't allow us to go where we want to go. When he keeps us from doing what we want to do. And when God takes something from us. Sometimes God will allow your home to be taken. Sometimes God will allow trouble to come our way so we can be tested to see if we will hold to his unchanging hand. And then right now, we are going through a lot of testing. Because God wants to know who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Who will have faith? Who will trust him? Who will not turn aside to the world? I encourage you tonight. Have faith. And I'll go down and read, look back at Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12, I'm going to read Hebrews 12, verse 4. And it reads, "You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. You have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as a son." He goes on to say, "My son, do not despise the chastising of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scorns every son whom he receives." We must endure, but if we get chastised, don't worry about it. Take it in stride. Matter of fact, give God glory. Because in the chastising, you are given endurance. You are being strengthened. You are being kept. You are being watched over. You are being guided. You are being given strength to carry on. You are given wisdom. God does not chastise us for any reason, but he gives it to us so we can endure. We can get through what we must get through. We must endure. And we must not waste our time with the world. The world is passing away. The world is passing away. Let me say that again for those who think that the world is just enduring and going on. The world is passing away. And those who are in sin are passing away. But God said, if you endure to the end, even if the end is tonight, even if the end is tomorrow, 3 weeks from now, a year from now, endure. Endure in faith and love. Trust God's will for your life. And everything will work out exactly the way he has planned it. And you will truly realize that Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. I will not keep you any longer, but I hope that you have gained some understanding of God's word tonight, that it would encourage you to go on and see what the end will be. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Veer not to the left nor to the right, but seek ye the kingdom of God while it is still time. Encourage someone out there to trust God. Encourage someone out there, because people are contemplating suicide. They are contemplating crimes. They are contemplating sin. We must encourage others to be strong and wait on the Lord. Of all things, wait on the Lord. Now, I'm going to give you the scripture for next week. And in these lessons that I'm giving you, it is actually preparing us for what is coming. Something bigger is coming. Something more difficult is coming. He has not allowed us to go through what we're going through so we can say everything is okay now. It's going to get a little harder. So he's guiding me. He's directing me to give you scripture that will encourage you and let you know that God has never left you nor forsaken you. And he will provide a way for you if you trust him. Next week's lesson will be coming from James. James, the first chapter, verses 1 through 4, with emphasis on verse 2. James, the first chapter, first through the fourth verse, emphasis on the second verse. Let us pray. Father, in your precious Son, Jesus' name, Lord Father, again, we thank you. I thank you, Lord, that you have allowed me to be humble, that you've allowed me to hear your voice. And Lord, you've allowed me to be obedient unto your word. I pray for those who have joined me tonight, Lord, in studying your word. I pray for them that they may be encouraged, that whatever comes, whatever may come our way, Lord, that we will remain strong, that we will remain steadfast and unmovable, that we will always abide in the word of truth, which is your word, and that we may have faith and endure to the end. Let us be encouragers, Lord. Allow us to encourage others. Give us the strength to pray for others. And Lord, when we go through our trials and our tribulations, let them not see the weariness, the weakness, but Lord, let them see you in us, that they may be encouraged and they may glorify your name in heaven. We love you today, Lord. I pray for my pastor. I pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. I pray for the co-pastor and his family. I pray for all, Father, the sound of my voice, those who will see this video later on. Father, I love you. I glorify you, magnify your name. And I thank you for this opportunity just to share a word with my brothers and sisters. Yet though we are away from each other, we are together. We are one because you have made us one. It is now in Jesus' name, Father, as I close out this night, I encourage them to go on, and I thank you for allowing us this opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. Another night the Lord has given us, and I thank you all. Be blessed, be encouraged, and know that God has never left us nor forsaken us. And be strong. Harder times are coming, but God is always there. All you got to do is call on his name, and everything will be all right. Be blessed. Have a good night. Love you all. Praying for you all, hoping to see you all soon. Be blessed.